Well, the information just keeps getting more and more and more extraordinary. Are we ready for it? Well, we have to be. Really, we have no choice. I was taking a nap today, and I was kind of, when I woke up, I suddenly got this idea. It was very strongly, pow, into my mind. And I just, where did that come from? I wasn't thinking anything about this. And suddenly this idea came to me and I began to pursue it. And I said, and it's opened up door after door after door after door. And my mind is just being, just having to, wow, I'm in the wow, wowness, which is where we're at right now, the wowness. And so remember that the discipline here is full stop in the wow, that we're doing this practice. This is practice, and we're practice hearing that which produces this really big wow in us. And we're not trying to be judgmental here. We're just opening our minds up to seeing what's going on as it is. As it is. And we remember that I am at home. I'm home. This is where I am, is now. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the demented stranger. Okay. In my home, fear is the demented stranger. I'm home. This is where I am. I'm home. This is where I am. Fear is the demented stranger here. And we will not be displaced or dispossessed of our home by this demented stranger who's an absolute stranger to this place. No, I'm not a stranger at all to my home. I'm absolutely at home. This is where I am is now. I feel perfectly right and just. I am not a stranger to my own home. Fear is the stranger. Fear is the demented stranger. So this is the practice the Holy Spirit gave me this morning. And I've been doing it. And I've been bouncing back. And tremendous clarification has been happening here, and how to narrate it here. We're living in extraordinarily intense times right now, and that's to say the very least. Most of us are a little bit behind, falling behind in terms of, you know, it's overwhelming, which is why this practice, full stop in the wow, is so important. If you embrace this practice, nothing will really overwhelm you, because you'll embrace the wow. You'll say, okay, wow, this is great. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And say, so, hey, I am at home. I'm home, and I feel at home being at home. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. I'm not a stranger. Fear is the stranger here. I'm not a stranger to my home. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the crazy, demented stranger here. I'm not going to listen to fear. I'm not going to be dispossessed by fear, dispossessed of my home. This is my home. This is where I belong. Okay? I'm not a stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. We must keep this attitude. This is flipping the script of the world. And I'm doing this today. The ego kept trying to come back on me. It's really extraordinary. The battle that's been going on in my mind is really quite extraordinary. And the Holy Spirit is helping out a lot. It's enlightening me to an overall extent of what's going on. So we can get into that a little bit here. But remember, our practice for the video is, you know, I am home. I am home. This is where I am. This is where I am now. This is where I am now, at home. I feel at home. I feel at home. And fear is the stranger here. I'm at home. This is where I am now. Fear is the stranger here. I'm not a stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. So, goodbye, stranger. I don't feel estranged at all here. See, I don't feel estranged. Fear feels estranged. And this enables us to stand up to the world. The world is really, well, we can get into it. I had this realization. The Holy Spirit opened these doors to information I did not know about. Quite extraordinary information. And somehow, started thinking about how to say it. This is the overall context of what's taking place here. And we're told, when they say peace and security, that's when you know you need to flee to the mountains, for the destruction is coming upon the world. Well, what do we have today? This is what everyone's saying. Well, finally, we have a nuclear treaty, peace and security. This is the big one, right? This really is the big one. That this so-called, finally, we have peace and security in our time. Peace from what? We feel like World War III, nuclear Armageddon and stuff. We finally have this treaty, supposedly. But we're told, and I think one of the letters of the New Testament, Thessalonians or something, that when they're saying peace and security, you know, that kind of thing, peace and safety, we finally have this, you know, this is when the trouble arrives upon us. Now, there's one other very important telltale sign that the Holy Spirit brought to my attention, not to be judgmental of people, but this is sort of a historic factual situation. The Holy Spirit said, hey, this idea was, do you realize what the abomination of desolation really is? It's actually gay marriage. And I said, what? It's like, huh? Gay marriage? Why is that? And I started thinking about it, and I said, wow. When the abomination of desolation is where it ought not, stands where it ought not be, where it is not where it ought not be, this is when then destruction, let flee, those are in Judea, flee to the hills. Destruction is very close. Now, the Bible uses the term abomination for sodomy over and over and over and over. This term is, it's an abomination. And the idea is to say the abomination of desolation. That means that there's no children. Desolation means emptiness, barrenness, sterility. Obviously, gays do not bring forth children. So from the standpoint of the Bible, you know, they say it's an abomination of desolation. And where it is, where it ought not be, let the reader understand, is what Jesus said. Then that's when your destruction is very close. Standing where it ought not be, where should this not be? It should not be given the same provenance, the same holiness sacrament as marriage between a man and a woman, obviously. So to elevate gay marriage to the same status as traditional marriage is what is to take the abomination of desolation and put it where it ought not be. Okay, and the Holy Spirit just completely opened my eyes to this, and I said, wow. I mean, I don't want to be judgmental. I'm not judgmental of people and what's going on. I say, well, let the Holy Spirit sort all out. But the Holy Spirit made it very clear, this is what at least the Bible was referring to as a certain milestone to look for before the great tribulation, that after this, then there'll be the greatest tribulation the world has ever experienced shortly after this. And so I used to think the abomination of desolation was like nuclear weapons or somehow, or an asteroid or something. What else? But I understand the abomination of desolation was really referring to people like genders get together. There's no children from it. And this is, it's sterile. It's barren. It's empty. It doesn't produce, you know, future generations of children. It's desolate. And so they call it an abomination of desolation. And then elevating that to the same status as traditional marriage is putting the abomination where it ought not be. And then let the reader understand what this refers to, where we get it now. It's already happened. And right on time, as I said, Jesus came back May 1st. He's already back in this world. And this ruling was on June 26, 2015. So very soon after, there is going to be tribulation breakout. And we are certainly, we know we're in that time frame now. Those who are really following this know. And I was told back in 2004 that 2015 was going to be the year for sure. But I didn't believe it because I thought that was too far off. I said, there's no way. I'm not going to be around but then. I can't take that. That's 11 more years. No way. It's under so much stress and strain. But we're here and it's all happening. So when I, and then I said, those are in Judea, let them flee to the hills. And I said, why does they say Judea? You know, what is this? Is it just about the Jews or something? Or this, isn't this a worldwide thing? So I began researching this whole thing about Judea, and this comes from Judah, actually. And so I reacquainted myself with the whole biblical story, you know, and got the whole context of the situation. It's quite fascinating, actually. Judah, actually, the term Jew comes from Judah. Judah was a fourth child of Jacob and Leah, okay? And the patriarchy goes, lineage goes from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob, basically. And the story of Judah is the fourth child of Jacob's first wife. The second child, wife was Rachel. This is the key story, one of the very key stories that we need to understand is Judah. This is where the term Jew comes from. And Judea, the term Judea, comes from the tribe of Judah. So Judah was Jacob's fourth son. And in this family, there was like 10 sons and 2 daughters. And the next to last son was named Jacob from Rachel. And I guess that was her first son. The last one was Benjamin. I think she died just right after that. So, and Jacob loved Rachel, his second wife. He had 2 concubines also, and with children. And so this son Jacob was, I mean, the son Joseph was very special to Jacob. And this son Joseph grew up dreaming that he was going to rule over everyone. And he had dreams that told him this, and he was a spoiled favorite child. The other sons didn't like this. They actually were so upset they plotted against his life, and they threw him into a deep dark pit from which he was going to die. And it was Judah, okay, who argued with and persuaded them not to kill Joseph, not to kill Joseph. He said, that's not right. Death, he doesn't deserve death. It's not right. This is very, very important in the history of the Bible, the history of right now, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I will explain this to you as we go along. So instead, they sold him into someone that took him down to Egypt and into slavery. And he was eventually cast into prison. And there's a long story about this. And then he was made vizier of Egypt. He was, his dreams were prophetic, and he saved the Pharaoh of Egypt from famine. Became super wealthy. He rented out lands and took a fifth of the profit of all those lands, agriculture. And he was the Pharaoh's favorite, really. Very smart. And this is one of the central stories in Judeo-Christian tradition. Now, eventually, the other offspring of Jacob came down to Egypt, because there was famine where they lived in the land of Canaan. There was famine there, the Holy Land. They came down to Egypt for grain, and eventually, they didn't know that Joseph had lived and what happened to him, and they didn't know he was this vizier of Egypt. He helped them out, and eventually, he told them who it was. They reconciled, and then they came down, and he gave them land, some in Goshen, some east delta of the east northeast delta of the Nile. They gave them land, okay, and so they all came down there, and they lived there, and they began to prosper, have offspring. And about 450 years passed, and they had multiplied, and become so prosperous that Egypt was afraid that they were going to take over Egypt. And that's when the Pharaoh at that time decreed that all the male, you know, offspring of be killed to protect Egypt. And that's when Moses, his mother protected Moses, and he was put in a reed basket and floated down the Nile. And then the Pharaoh's wife found him, and then eventually Moses gained a lot of power and then led them out of Egypt, the Jews out of Egypt. Exodus. Okay, now Moving along, another very important fact is that there's 42 stations of Exodus where they went 42 different places until finally they reached the Promised Land. Very, very interesting. Just a very interesting side note. Jesus, his first coming was the station number 43, and his second coming is station number 44, actually, which is leading us completely out of exile. Okay, the 42 stations led to the Promised Land, but it was in this world. 43, Jesus comes in and so promises us 44, the 44th station. And that is very important. Now, when Jacob died, he chose Judah to be his heir. Okay, so Judah was then to rule over all the kingdoms of Israel. Jacob was also called Israel, and so the tribe of Judah was given this, you know, southern part of the area, which is around Jerusalem, that's called Judea, and up even to this, you know, for a long time it was called that, and then of course Israel is now named after Jacob. So, through Judah, his lineage ultimately produced what? King David. And King David united all the tribes. See, there was, Jacob had the children, all sort of, each one had turned into a tribe, so to speak. And initially, they didn't really recognize Judah and Benjamin, which are the southern tribes, and the northern ones in the northern tribe that got into idolatry and all this. And eventually, King David united all the tribes. Okay, then, so Judah, who now, what is so important about Judah? We'll get back to this, but let's follow King David. King David, they said the Messiah will come from the line of King David. Jesus is from the lineage of King David. Okay, very important. They say salvation comes through the lineage of Judah, through you know, King David lineage, and Jesus came through that lineage. Very important. Why is this? Why? And I'll tell you why. Because Judah was the one that rejected death. See, the others said, look, we want to get what we want to get, and this guy is standing in our way. We have an easy solution. We'll kill him, plain and simple. And Judah said no to death. He says, we won't use death. I will not use death as a means to get what I want. This is crucial. This is the most crucial part of the, you know, of ancient history, patriarchal history, is Judah refusing. See, initially, Abraham was going to sacrifice Isaac, and then God said, no, instead sacrifice this sheep. Okay, so, oh, okay. But Judah was different. Judah, through his own clarity, spirituality, said, no, this is not right. This is not, death is not right. I reject death. Let us find a better way than this. Let us find a better way. So, who is the absolute epitome of rejecting death and saying, let us find a better way, let us find eternal life? Jesus is. Absolutely. And Jesus is from the lineage of Judah, actually. He's a Jew. Now, the term Jew really refers to those of the tribe of Judah. And it's not really a lineage, a flesh lineage. It's a spiritual tribe, actually. The tribe of Judah is a spiritual tribe. Real Jews, it's a spiritual tribe. Okay, it's a spiritual lineage, not DNA lineage or racial lineage. It's spiritual. It's those who, not only have they rejected idolatry, which is what the original, you know, Abraham, that the lineage is they first rejected idolatry, which is important, very important. But Judah not only rejected idolatry, he rejected death. And that is absolutely crucial. So Jews are those who rejected idolatry and rejected death. They say, no, I will not use death as a remedy for anything. I will not do it. This is a spiritual tribe. And so Jesus is the head of that spiritual tribe, absolutely. He's the king of the Jews. Okay, Jesus is the king of the Jews, meaning king of that spiritual tribe, and we're to follow his advice on rejecting death, absolutely rejecting it. Now the Holy Spirit pointed out to me, well, look at your life. I said, wow, yeah, I rejected death when I was 22, completely rejected it, and I saw it. It does nothing, you know. It's fake. It's false. So I've been following Jesus, King of the Jews, for, you know, for almost 40 years, intensely, in regard to the falsity of death. So I'm actually a Jew. Absolutely, I'm a Jew. Spiritual of the tribe of Judah, which is a spiritual tribe. And you know, you're not born a Jew, really. It's a spiritual tribe. I mean, you have to enter that tribe spiritually. Now, the northern tribes, who eventually they split away from David and went their own way back into idolatry. And what happened to them? Well, the Assyrians conquered them and took them. The Assyrians were very nasty folks. They didn't mess around. Every spring, the war machine got geared up, and they would head out to parts unknown and just conquer. What they do is they brought the people back, and then they would split them up all over the place, completely split them up, decimate their land, split them up and put them into various places, and that was it. You never heard from those people again. So the 10 tribes of Israel, the northern tribes, they, once the Syrians got a hold of them, they disappeared from history, completely disappeared. Nobody knows exactly what happened to them. There's a lot of people talking about what happened to them. They say, well, they went all over the world. Well, they probably did. But keep in mind that these are not the real Jews at all. Okay, the real Jews is a spiritual lineage from Judah. The tribe of Judah, the one who rejected death and even offered himself as a substitute, offered his life as a substitute for Benjamin, his younger son. So if you know, I will, if we, if Benjamin doesn't come back, whatever the thing with Egypt, then I'll give my life, you know, I'll give my life for that. So he was willing to give his life for his younger brother, and he rejected death. So this, the Judah was a precursor of Jesus Christ, actually. Quite interesting. So this information, the Holy Spirit just opened my eyes to it, and I said, wow, yeah, this is really amazing. So the people in Judea, what does that mean? It means the tribe, the Jews, the tribe of Judah, the Jews, who are, it's a spiritual tribe, those who reject death, they need to quote unquote flee to the hills, flee to the highlands. Now, we're talking about the Exodus, the 42 steps, and the 43rd, and then the 44th. Where are those places? Where is place number 44 is the question. And it's very interesting that the 44th station that Jesus represents, is his second coming, is also happening at the exact same time as the 44th president in the United States is here, who is the one who is claiming, you know, peace and security in our time. I finally, you know, solved the problems of the world here. We're told to look out for that for sure. So we have a little bit of a wow here. This is the information is just coming very quickly now. Same time the POTUS who proclaims, you know, oh, you know, I am the peacemaker, the man of lawlessness who doesn't, man of lawlessness refers to the POTUS who refuses to do anything within the Constitution. So he just says, well, this is executive decision. This treaty, I don't need to go through Congress. It's an executive decision. You know, this is just completely lawless. His whole tenure has been one of lawlessness. Who just, you know, if the Constitution, if there's something in my way, I'll just go right around and do it anyway. It doesn't matter. As a man of lawlessness who's claiming, you know, peace in our time, we finally have peace and security, I'm the great peacemaker and all this kind of stuff. So this is the time, the end times. fleeing to a higher place, being ready to go to a higher place, the 44th station of Exodus. Where is that place? Is it in this world? That's the question. Is it even in this world? Coming to see Jesus in the gospel was the 43rd station of Exodus. So the 42 gets to the promised land. Jesus is the 43rd, first coming of Jesus. We spend time considering his words and practicing as he told us to practice, as we started this video out saying, I am home. This is where I am now. I am not a stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. The demented fear is the stranger here. Not me. I am not a stranger in my own home. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. The Holy Spirit has told me to practice this. Very important. This is where I am now. And this is the 44th station. Now, is it in this world or it'll be out of this world? I don't know yet. I don't know. But this is the second coming of Christ, which happened May 1st, 2015. And very interestingly, we have at the end of June, okay, the Star of Bethlehem reappears, which is the conjunction of Saturn? Or Jupiter? Venus and Jupiter? Yeah, Jupiter. Venus and Jupiter. Is this still going? Yeah. Star of Bethlehem. It hasn't appeared for, they say, since a long time. AD 03 or something. But it's a sign that Jesus is back. The wise men followed the Star of Bethlehem to take him where the Messiah was. Well, Messiah had already been born. So the Star of Bethlehem comes after the Messiah is born. So Jesus returned to this world, and the Star of Bethlehem appears. None of these things can, and then the abomination of desolate, which maketh desolate, which is really the way it said, the abomination which maketh desolate, meaning gay marriage, same genders getting married, there's no offspring, no natural offspring from that. So it's fundamentally makes desolate, you know, the continuation of offspring. Well, that gets elevated to a place where it should not be, which means same sanctity as male and female marriage. We're told that, then look for the great tribulation to follow right on the heels of that. And then we have the treaty today, nuclear treaty, peace and security, which is all we're also told is a certain sign that after that, you know, look out. And then we have Jade Helm starting on the exact same day, 15th of July. Coincidence? I don't think so. Yeah, there's too many things going on to be coincidence here. So the people who are really digging into this and realize, hey, we are absolutely in the end times right now. The 44th station of Exodus is now. This is where we need to get to. This is where we need to get to. So, you know, it's not an aberration at all that I'm talking about this, because I am of the tribe of Judah, absolutely. Someone who who's rejected death to such an extraordinary extent as I have, my entire life I've been this way, and very, very adamant about it, and have studied my entire life about this. This has been my focus, you know, the whole life. You know, that's a certain sign of someone who's of the tribe of Judah, which was started by the one who decided to reject death. I'm not going to use death to resolve anything. Okay, that's so important. And then Jesus is the King of the Jews. And so, of course, I'm in touch with Jesus. Those who are of the same mindset of Jesus, Jesus knows them, and they know Jesus. So, and it's not a problem for me, because we're the same, you know, outlook. Saying, yeah, death is a complete self. It's an attempt to deceive God. And of course, bodies are just the instruments of death. Death made bodies. The dream of death made bodies. You have to have bodies in order to die. In order to claim that spirit has died, we have to have bodies. So that's the only purpose of bodies, is to die and to try to deceive guilt into thinking spirits died. And of course, there isn't any guilt, because we did not modify God's will at all. Saying that there's guilt is total arrogance. Total arrogance. And it was really the feeling of impossibility of changing reality we felt We insisted, our arrogance said, no, it's guilt. We did it, but we feel guilty. So now we're trying to trick guilt into thinking that spirit is paying for the guilt by dying and getting rid of it that way. But of course, spirit can't die. So what does it do? It makes bodies so the bodies die. So death is a total scam. It's a completely unnecessary scam. Bodies are a complete scam. It's totally unnecessary. The only purpose of bodies is for bodies to die, ultimately. And thereby trick guilt. And we try to make bodies really glamorous and wonderful, so we think guilt will say, oh yeah, that must be spirit. So we try to invest spirit in bodies, so to speak, so as if that makes it more believable that when bodies die, that means that spirit has died. Which is why Jesus died this very ignoble death. You know, he didn't try to invest anything in the body, you know, just bleeding on a torture and bleeding on a cross. You know, they said, why don't you save yourself? So I'm not trying to invest spirit in the body at all. Okay, the body is just a tool of death. That's all it is. So when we see, you know, people just, you know, glamorizing themselves, you know, so much, trying to appear to be, you know, these fantastic, wonderful bodies, it's to try to make the sacrifice of the body seem to be more realistic to guilt. But since there isn't any guilt, we don't need to sacrifice the body at all, really. And so all is forgiven. I mean, you know, it's not like we're judging that those who try to glamorize the body are bad. It's just unnecessary. There's no need for any death. There's not even need for any bodies. If you don't need death, you don't need bodies. See, no need for death. Well, why do we need the body? That's ridiculous. When spirit sees this, it says, who wants to hang out with, you know, as flesh when we're actually spirit, which is eternally free, unencumbered in any way? There's no encumbrance in any way. You know, it's ridiculous. I mean, we could use the body as a communication device to help explain this to others, but the body loses its relevance, you know, when you realize death is just a completely unnecessary attempt to trick guilt that doesn't exist. So, whatever anybody may think one way or the other, for instance, about gay marriage, it still is the signpost, that we were to look for, that was told in the Bible, that when this happens, then look out for the tribulation to come. Okay, so that's the way to look at it. You know, you know, the people, some people think, oh, it's a great thing. I know there's a lot of people that think it's the best thing that's ever happened in the world. Others think it's a terrible thing. And then others are saying, well, you know, maybe it's okay. And others say, you know, maybe it's not so okay. It's a spectrum. It's a spectrum of opinion on all this. But that's not the issue. The issue is that it happened. Okay, the Supreme Court gestures. This is the ruling. That means this has been elevated to where it ought not to be, according to the Bible. You would recognize. It was just a way of saying, recognize this when this happens. Recognize that tribulation is now near. It's not saying, you know, condemn them or, you know, anything like that. It's saying, get ready for tribulation. That's what's important. And ultimately, I don't know, you know, what the Holy Spirit's outlook on that is. I would say pragmatically that it presents a lot of problems for sure, but ultimately I'll let the Holy Spirit judge that. What's important is that it means that tribulation is here. It means that tribulation is here. Everything is happening to show that it is here. Now we're told, I've certainly been told by the Holy Spirit that an asteroid will come in at some point. It seems very likely, and that's in the Revelation also, a bright burning star coming down and turning things into blood red or something. I mean, there's imagery that we're shown that certainly seems to be an asteroid coming in. That's part of the tribulation. There's a lot of different parts of the tribulation. It's just a very chaotic time of great difficulty. But those who have repented will be saved from the time of tribulation. Now, to repent means not to decide that death is a, realize that death is a scam. It's just an attempt to deceive guilt, which doesn't exist. And repent says, I'm not going to use death anymore. I'm no. And I very clearly remember that in my life. And you know, almost every day I have to keep, you know, affirming, so I'm not going to use death as an excuse for anything, as a solution for anything. Absolutely not. I took it off the plate entirely. I said, I will not use it as an explanation. I'm going to find the truth. I'm going to find the truth, and death is not the truth. That is for sure. It doesn't separate us from truth either. And okay, so those who have repented most certainly are going to be saved. And again, Jesus says attack is never justified. Never justified. So certainly you're not going to solve anything by attacking anyone or anything, by bringing death upon anyone at all. It doesn't solve anything. What's going to happen to those who have repented, those who are saved? Well, we're told they will not have to suffer, you know, the tribulation time. So we will, you know, we'll find out as we go along how that plays out. But I'm certainly within my rights to talk about this. There's no question about it, because I have absolutely dedicated my life to exposing death as the imposter that it is. It's an imposter. It's a scam. It's a fraud. It's not needed. It's a dream. We're imagining it all. We're not bound by death in the slightest bit. We just in our arrogance thought this is how we can trick guilt. We can make guilt believe that we spirit has died in order to pay the price for killing God. You see, and so we're trying to convince guilt that bodies are really what spirit is now. Spirit's been changed into bodies. It's not true. Spirit can never become a body. It's impossible. Absolutely impossible. Because body is just a figment of our imagination. How can the dreamer become the dream? You know, become some figure in a dream, some imaginary stick figure in a dream? It's not possible. That's mixing cause and effect. Cause is always cause, effect is always effect. Yeah, they're two sides of one coin, but one preceded the other. I mean, in terms of will, spiritual desire and will, it's the desire, it's the cause that produces the effects. The effects do not produce the cause. The effects give testimony to the cause, right? Absolutely, but they do not produce themselves. It's very important to realize this. Now, when I grew up, most of my friends were Jewish for some reason, but they were more of the 10 tribes type of Jewish people. They weren't really very into, you know, spiritual truth at all. They went on to become, you know, doctors and lawyers and rich business people and all sorts of things. The 10 tribes, the lost 10 tribes, they're technically, again, they're not really what we call as the spiritual Jews. They're not. They're not now they certainly are very talented, but they're quite worldly, actually. Very, very worldly. And they certainly have acquired a great deal of power in the world. There's no question about that. Running a lot of the major institutions of the world, entertainment, banking, news, you name it. They are very much part of the global infrastructure. They have a tremendous influence in that. But those are not the real Jews at all. Okay, the real Jews is a spiritual tribe. Keep that in mind. It's a spiritual identity. Not a worldly identity. Spiritual identity. Jesus came, I came to save the Jews. I came to, right? That's what he started out teaching, that he came for the Jews. Well, he meant those of Judah who had rejected death, rejected idolatry, rejected death. That's who he came for. Absolutely. That's still who he comes for. But he spread the gospel out throughout the world, so realizing this was not a flesh lineage, but a spiritual tribe, that people from all over can be part of this tribe. Jew coming from Judah, the one who rejected both idolatry and death. This is the ones in Israel right now, are they Jews? Are they more the ten tribes? They're more the 10 tribes, aren't they? I mean, if you're living in Israel and you're really spiritual and rejecting death and all that stuff, you find yourself rather isolated. You know, it's like you realize, hey, most of these people don't really believe that. You know, they're into worldly power, worldly control, worldly success, worldly domination. The real Jews are not into worldly domination. They're into they're transcendentalists. They believe that Jesus has another place for them to dwell. But this world is not their true dwelling place at all. Now, it's possible, even while you're here, to live, reject death entirely, and live in an enlightened condition. Absolutely it is. When you say, I am home. This is where I am now. This is my home. This is where I am now. Fear is the stranger here. You can literally drive out all these death thoughts. Okay. They can all vanish. And you can, certainly, Jesus talks about this in his teachings. And I've gone over and over and over and over, and we're not going to get into that necessarily right now. But we can have a vision that's free of death. And keep in mind that Jesus says, first you see all your brothers as holy. And he used brothers as a general term, talking about spiritual brothers, which is a gender-neutral term. And you see everyone as spiritual, not as a body, not as flesh. And then Jesus says, when you do that, you realize that the holy vision that you're seeing everyone is within you. Therefore, you must be holy. You who are host to this vision, you also must be holy then, because lies and deception cannot host this vision of holiness. So first he says you see everyone else is holy, and then you realize that you too are holy. He says that's how it works. So I can accept this. It sounds very reasonable. So we can have this vision of holiness even while we're here in this world. That doesn't necessarily mean that there isn't some other place that Jesus has prepared. When he left, he said, that's what I'm going to do. Now keep in mind, you know, we say, well, okay, Jesus was from the northern part of Judea. Well, once the 10 tribes were gone, they were gone. And so then of course the Jews in Judea, which is Jerusalem area, Bethlehem, that area, southern part. Of course, the Babylonians came and took them into the Babylonian exile, captivity and exile. And eventually they came back, you know, and the temple was rebuilt. And then they gradually grew and prospered, and some of they spread to the north more. So some spread into the north Galilee area, etc. So Jesus, of course, a lot of the apostles were from the Sea of Galilee area. But there are also the Samaritans, which were people who were more involved with idolatry, and the Canaanites, and they were supposed to be they were like the bad Jews, the ones that are not still keeping the faith. So Jesus, he did call his apostles, and they were all Jews. He said, I came to save the Jews. I'm the Messiah of the Jews, yeah. And meaning spiritual, the spiritual tribe. Has nothing to do with... So I don't come from a Jewish family, but most of my friends were Jewish. I think the only ones that could keep up with my intellect, you know, to a certain extent, at least relate to it a little bit. I've never identified as racially Jewish at all, but my mind is obviously attuned to Jesus, and have the spiritual heritage of true Jewishness, the spiritual heritage of it. Now the Pharisees, they went into psychology a lot, and they didn't understand what Jesus was talking about, actually. So they, introspection and deeper thinking was part of the Jewish heritage. There's no question about it. And reading subtler, you know, they're able to get a subtler picture in a lot of ways, and greater depth. And some dug deeper and deeper and deeper, deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. So, you know, really, Christianity, Judeo-Christianity, the Christians are you know, should be part, you know, part of the tribe of Judah, Jewish. I mean, coming from that heritage, Judeo-Christian heritage. Now, and you know, not all of them have rejected death, and many, in fact, many of them think that Jesus is coming back to slaughter all their enemies, like a, you know, like some super King David, or you know, was able, you know, a great warrior or something. That, you know, no, the tribe is not coming from David directly. It comes from Judah. Okay, Judah was the one who rejected death. And ultimately, it comes from Abraham, which God said, "Hey, Abraham, you know, you're still thinking about, you're still willing to sacrifice your son." Say, "Don't do it. I don't want you to do that anymore." You see, get away from human sacrifice. Get away from that. And of course, the ancient lands used human sacrifice to Baal. You know, the god of Baal, he used a tremendous amount of human sacrifice, actually, took place back there. And so he said, "Look, you got to go on a path now away from that. And ultimately, away from all sacrifice, all death, and reject death altogether." That's why Jesus could raise the dead. You know, he realized that death is nothing but a scam. It's all it is. Completely unnecessary. Totally irrelevant. Has no relevance to anything whatsoever. And so he'd say, "Lazarus, you know, get up. I told you to get up. Just get up. You know, who are you trying to fool, Lazarus? You're not fooling me one bit. You know, death doesn't fool me one bit. Get up." And Lazarus goes, "Oh yes, Lord, okay, I remember now, yeah." And so he, you know, just rises from the dead. You know, it's not a big deal. You know, once you see, it has no relevance whatsoever. Now, so the real Jews really don't have relationship with the 10 tribes, the lost 10 tribes at all. Because they were not part of this whole spiritual, you know, lineage, spiritual tribe, actually. And so we can be very critical of the world and say, "Hey, you know, this stuff is not good, it's not helpful. Turn away from that." And insist on, you know, much stricter, you know, rules, regulations, governing morality, and discipline and simplicity and all this kind of stuff, which helps our spiritual practice. We're, you know, very engaged in spiritual practice. That's the life that we're called to. So we're talking about Jesus here as right we should, absolutely. He came back, he said, "I'm back," and who heard him? Well, obviously, the real Jews, those who were prepared, would hear that and realize, yeah, he is back. I had my ears attuned to that, I had my spiritual ears attuned, I heard it, I acknowledged it. I said, "Okay, great." Most of the world, you know, is asleep to that. They sound asleep, they didn't hear it. Perfect timing coming back, right? Because all this stuff is happening. So we realize the wow is a big wow factor here, because this is very intense information. Explains a lot. how the lost 10 tribes and the works that they're involved in right now, they tried to, you know, seduce me, convince me that we were, you know, brothers, you know, we should be accepting of one another and we're engaged in the same work. I said, that's nonsense. Who are you trying to kid? No way. You went a different way. You went the way of the world. Rejected what was offered to you, you know. You went the way of idolatry. So, you know, like I said, Hollywood is just a complete obscenity. It's just an idolatrous, you know, vicious ball-worshipping obscenity. Absolutely it is. So, I'm not going to agree to some sort of racial solidarity when what we're talking about is a spiritual identity here. That's not going to fly at all. Yeah, like I said, fear is the stranger here. I'm at home. Fear is the stranger here. Say that. I am at home. This is where I am now. Fear is the stranger here. I am not a stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is that demented stranger here. And it's fear that must leave. I will not be dispossessed by a demented stranger who's a complete alien here in my home. Right? And the home, of course, is a spiritual home. True identity, without all this nonsense of trying to convince some non-existent nothing that I'm something other than what I am, in order to prove that, or able to believe that we can change the will of God and have a experience based on that, which we cannot. So is it not right that that people recognize their king? Of course. So of course I recognize Jesus. He's the one who's bringing the gospel that helps us see through the charade of death and has very beautifully helped unravel all the defenses and entanglements that, you know, and trickery that we used on ourselves and has helped us, you know, he's the ultimate psychologist for sure. You know, the 10 tribes may have their Freud and Adler and Jung and, you know, Karen Horney and on and on and on and on. All their psychoanalysts, okay, that can, you know, help them, you know, feel more integrated or whatever. But the tribe of Judah, the real Jews have Jesus. And he's the greatest psychologist there is. So I've been in therapy with Jesus for 40 years. That's the therapy I've been in. Now, it still isn't easy. I still have thoughts. You know, my mind is still occupied with past thoughts. And it's not easy to part those clouds. Keep trying. Sometimes they spontaneously have experienced them just disappearing. And then it comes back. Had dreams last night, very heavy. It's like I was a guru, a spiritual teacher, and everybody was trying to help, asking me to solve their problems, and yeah, it was very heavy stuff. But I don't need that stuff too. Those are still thoughts. Those aren't needed. And sometimes I can see it, and other times it's perplexing. And I can't quite see why or how to get free of them like that. So, you know, it's tough therapy, to say the least. A couple of days ago, I was very clearly seeing Adam. Like, I just got to get rid of all dreaming. Doesn't matter what the content is. It doesn't make any difference at all. And this is what you have to tell others. As long as they're insisting that, you know, that the content of this world makes difference, judgment, then you're going to be trapped in this heaviness. And you're not functioning as a true teacher. You cannot be trapped. You must be light. You must be very light. You're not trapped at all. None of this has any relevance whatsoever. Totally unnecessary, totally irrelevant. There's nothing to solve. There's no need for any judgment between illusions at all. So this is the ultimate parting, you know. You know, it's not enough just to be a rabbi or a psychologist, help people with their problems, wise person. That's not it. That's not what Jesus is talking about. I mean, he upset the rabbis greatly, you know, of the time. I mean, they said, you're too radical. I mean, this is I don't get this at all. So we're supposed to set death down. Say, I don't need this at all. Setting death down is similar to setting the body down, actually. The body, again, is just a tool that death is using to try to witness to itself. Trying to con non-existence, something that doesn't exist. Again, how can we trick what doesn't exist? This is what we have to keep reminding ourselves. How can we trick what doesn't exist? When we realize this, then the game is up. You know, how can we trick something that doesn't exist? We can't. It's ridiculous to even try. So we give up trying, that's all. I mean, ultimately salvation is just a realization that trying to trick something that doesn't exist is completely ridiculous. So there's no need to do it. There isn't any need to do it whatsoever. Why do we need to keep trying to trick what doesn't exist and what will never exist? Why do we need to keep trying to trick it? So most people don't want to give up their death because they think it's the only way to salvation. They think, I have to trick guilt in order to be saved from this feeling of impossibility, which I thought was guilt, which I told myself was guilt. So they think death is all important. I mean, if they were immortal, they'd say, oh my gosh, this is the worst thing ever. I'll never be able to be free of guilt. Right? But if you realize there is no guilt, so we're trying to get free of nothing. We're trying to deceive nothing at all. Then you realize, well, why should I die? That's ridiculous. Why? I don't need death. I don't need a death body. I can have a light body. Let this body be transformed into a body of light. And that's not so, that's shocking then. But most people would say, oh, no. I got to be vulnerable. I got to die. It's very important. I just want to figure out how to be happy before I die. And resolve all these issues I'm having with other people who want to die. And they know this. That's not spiritual teaching. Spiritual teaching has to center on death and the freedom from death, or it's not real spiritual teaching. Jesus said the last obstacle that will be overcome will be death. Because that's the first obstacle, right? The first will be last. I mean, the scheme was to fake our death. So all this, we've just been trying to fake our own death. That's all we've been trying to do. And guess what? Faking your death doesn't mean you've died at all. We've never died. We've never even been born. We've just been trying to fake our death. Now, since this is a spiritual tribe, anyone can be accepted into this tribe. I was accepted. I had a dream years ago where I was accepted into this spiritual tribe. There's no question about it. I found myself invited to this big very important gathering, and I found I was a guest of honor, and every single person there greeted me and with great happiness and welcoming. And these people were very, very significant people, great, great people, you know, like apostles. I mean, they were really spiritually wonderful, and they treated me like, you know, just, I was just astounded by it. I was overwhelmed by it. Not a single one held back, and they all made a point to come up and welcome me into the fold, so to speak. Like I was one of the lost sheep, you know, they're bringing back, you know, the lost sheep into the fold, and I was one who had been brought back into the fold. So they were very super, super pleased to see me come back into the fold, so to speak. And this is the experience I'm sure everyone will have. Like the prodigal story, the prodigal son is the one that comes back. God just throws a big party, is because, you know, he's been without this one. This one's been gone for so long. And it's so happy that they're back. Now, I don't know who these people in the dream were. I don't know. But they're all were very kind and heartfelt and genuine, and I felt totally supportive of me. I don't know where they are, or, you know, I haven't. somewhere, I guess. Are they in any of them here in the world? I don't know. They may not need to be, of course. They don't need death at all. They realize there's absolutely no need for it whatsoever. So why would they take on a flesh body? It's ridiculous. Why do that? So we are in the apocalypse. Of course, it means the lifting of the veil, as I've said many times. And all these things are being made clear now. Now, this gay marriage thing, well, it's kicked a lot of people in the gut. I know someone, a Christian, he's never been the same since. I didn't say anything, but that on that day he was inconsolable. He couldn't even talk to people. Very, very strong, good Christian. Works real hard at it, and he hasn't been the same since. I talked with him today. I said, "How's the world treating you?" And he said, "It's collapsing, you know. It's collapsing real fast." So, he, you know, is a kick in the gut and I think what it really is that they realize is the time now is Jesus, you know, the return of Jesus is here now. And are they ready is the question. And honestly, you know, there's a lot of them who have not rejected death yet. They keep thinking that Jesus is coming back to slaughter their enemies, you know, and clean up the earth and get rid of the lost 10 tribes and all their works, gambling and entertainment and news and politics and money changing. I mean, and Jesus got real mad at the money changers, didn't he? They're angry or intense about it and say, "Hey, you know, well, there's a ton of money changing going on, isn't there? Behind the scenes, the banksters and what's being controlled, there's, you know, usury, you know, that's what they're very good at. And money lending and money changing and all this, the system of the beast, the economic system, is terrible." So Jesus, you know, really absolutely threw them out of the temple. But so they're thinking that he's going to come back and throw them out of the temple again. But of course, they came right back. So I think throwing them out of the temple, you know, is a sign, like saying, "Look, this, don't fall into this stuff trap. Be aware of what's going on, and so we have this situation in the world that is now just going, you know, out of control. So every day is another great leap to, we're going real big, really, 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 really big. And we got to stay ahead of the times now. And I feel that we are doing that. We're doing that. I did a video yesterday and the Holy Spirit stopped it. And I felt it wasn't good enough. I kept trying, so this isn't really good enough. And then I did a second part, and I tried to edit, I edited it together. And I said, you know, I don't think I'm going, I want to release this one because it's flat. It's a failure. You know, it's one of my few ones that I felt I didn't go big enough. I could go bigger, you know. It's sort of like that. It's like I did go big in various ways, but the Holy Spirit told me, you need to go bigger than that. And I had something happen to me today where I was picking up rubble, bricks. And I picked up too many bricks. I picked up two, and then I tried to pick up a third, and somehow the bricks slipped out of my hand. I don't even understand how it happened. And it didn't hardly fall at all. It just tipped it. Somehow it hit my thumb, my thumbnail, and it just hit in the worst place, and it was brutally painful. My thumb is all black and blue now, and I couldn't believe it. I said, that's crazy. Yeah, I can see if a brick falls from a distance, but this didn't fall from a distance, but the effect was just astonishingly painful. And I said, well, obviously this is something Holy Spirit's trying to get my attention. He's saying something, don't do something. Something you've done, you're rushing it. You know, just let it go. And I wasn't sure what it was, and I finally realized it was the video. There's two bricks, two segments of the video, trying to put them together for a third. And it's that third one that fell and hit my thumb. And I realized that it didn't go big enough. We have to go bigger than this. And it's true. I sort of lapsed down into a place where I've already been, and I didn't really transcend, you know. It wasn't transcendent enough. And so I've been able to come up then with this video, which is transcendent enough. Absolutely, this does have escape velocity, and that's what we need right now, is everyday escape velocity. So, fear is the stranger here. I'm at home. Fear is the stranger here. I am at home. This is where I am now. And fear is the stranger here. Not me. Fear is the stranger. You must keep flipping the tables on fear. It keeps trying to tell you that you're a stranger to your own home. That you're a stranger to truth. You don't belong there. It'll keep insisting that, but we keep pushing back and insisting, no. I am at home. This is where I am now. Fear is the stranger here. I am at home. This is where I am now. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the stranger. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm at home. This is where I am now. Fear is the stranger here. Beautiful night here. Warm weather is back. You know, the tape outdoors is very mild. A letting this sink in. See, this is very important. We're not dealing with sound bites here. We're letting, this is heavy, 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 enlightening information. It's heavy in its lightness. Okay, the lightness is seems to be very heavy because it's, wow, what's happening to my heaviness? It's disappearing. This is very heavy in a different way, right? It's like a wow type of heaviness. But once we get used to the wow heavy, then we keep lightening up, lightening up, lightening up, lightening up even more and more and more and more and more. So we see we have an overview of what's taking place. We don't need to get bogged down in all the details of this and the politics of this and all this kind of nonsense. We can recognize the big picture here. Stations of Exodus, you know, 42, Moses had 42, and then 43rd was Jesus. First coming of Jesus. Now the second coming, Jesus, second advent is 44. During the 44th presidency of the United States, quite interestingly enough. Now, there's the POTUS wants to be the Messiah. He's competing with the Messiah, trying to do things. Let's not do it through death. Let's do it peacefully. And, you know, I'm a great, you know, bringer of peace, 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 peace. But that's not Jesus. Jesus is transcendent of that. It's to recognize the whole complete irrelevancy of this dream. Not to be a king over the dream, but to recognize the irrelevancy. There's a very different Messiah. The POTUS number 44 wants to be a historically great figure, wants to continue this world and everything that's going on, and people to regard him as the Messiah, bringing peace to the world. See, Jesus didn't come to bring peace to the world. He said he came to bring the sword to differentiate, you know, to help us, the sword of differentiation, the sword of reason, to recognize, hey, wait a minute, we don't even need this world. We don't need bodies. We don't need a world. We don't need nature. We don't need this universe. We don't need any of this dream. It's all a scam. It's all an attempt to try to deceive God. It's all based on arrogance, actually. See, that's a very different Messiah, right? Jesus has no interest to try to be some president or make peace treaties or go down historically as some great leader, anything like that. So you got someone who's trying to pretend to be the Messiah, you know, called false Messiah, false Messiah. So don't look for Jesus to be a king of this world. That is not how it is. He even said, this world is not my world. What are you talking about? This is not my kingdom at all. I'm going back to my Father's kingdom. This place is the prince, belongs to the Prince of Darkness. Made that very, very clear. So why would anyone expect him to dwell here? No, he's going to dwell in his Father's kingdom. That's where he calls us to. He doesn't call us to dwell here and be happy here. He calls us to our Father, his Father, and our Father's kingdom, where there is no death, there's no attempt, there's no guilt, there's no attempt to get rid of guilt through death. We don't have to pretend we're something that we're not. All is well, all is perfect. And, you know, they tried to make him, you know, king, and they said, yeah, you're king of the Jews. You know, he didn't deny it, you said it. They had him go into Jerusalem, hail the Hosanna, Hosanna, King of the Jews. Well, he was the king of the spiritual Jews, yeah. Not the secular ones, though. Not the worldly ones. He's not their king. They're looking for a King David, a warrior king. And Jesus said, no, I'm the king, but not that type of king. They said, where's your kingdom? You're a king. Where's your kingdom? My kingdom is within. It's within? Yeah, kingdom of heaven. It's right here, right now. I'm home. This is where I am right now. This is where I am right now. This is where I am now. This is where I am is now. This is home. I'm home here. I'm not a stranger here. Fear is a stranger here. Fear is a stranger here. So a lot of people are putting tribulation to start in 2015. I've certainly put it there. I said starting June 22nd, 2015, it's going to start spinning out of control. A year of extreme intensity, and we had better be confirmed in our repentance by June 22nd, 2016, or I feel it may be too late by that time. You see? So that's why we're having to go big right now. I mean, pressured to every day, you know, go really big and take another leap, take another leap, take another leap. You know, gathering the lost sheep of Israel. Gathering the lost sheep, that's what Jesus does. Gathering the lost sheep of Israel, which is, you know, really gathering the tribe of Judah. Because Israel gave, you know, said to Judah, you'll be the king, you'll be the lineage holder, you know. That was Jacob, Israel. So the lost sheep of Israel is the spiritual tribe of Judah. Which those who've rejected death and said, no, death is we don't need it. Reject it because there's no need for it at all. It's a scheme targeting nothing at all. Oh, I've always been outraged by death, completely outraged by it. It's just, I absolutely could never tolerate it in any way. So this is completely ridiculous. What a joke. I even, as a child, I was that way. I'd see stuff die. I said, what are you doing? Like an ant dies. It was stupid. Get up. You don't have to be dead. Why are you playing dead like that? It's all a play. You know, I saw that bee die here recently. I said, bee, get up. Fly away. Why are you pretending to be dead? That's stupid. There's no application for this whatsoever. So I've always been this way. Absolutely. Same thing with sickness. Same thing with sickness. Anything else, just, you know, why be sick? There's no application for it. No application for it, so just don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. It's that simple. Let it go, let it go. Let sickness go, let death go, let it all go. Don't need it. And of course, you have to see clearly, you know, why we don't need it. Why did we think that we needed it in the first place is what's important to see. Because we say we don't need it, so why do we have it in the first place then? This is the obvious question. So the answer to that is, I've answered that very, very clearly. The Holy Spirit has helped me share the answer, which is that we wanted to change the will of God. All right, we wanted to be greater than God. We wanted to change the will of God. We couldn't do it. We felt it's impossible. We can't do it. And in order to keep entertaining this idea, we said, "Oh no, it's we did it, but we feel guilty about it." That's why it's not a feeling of impossibility, it's a feeling of guilt. And then We said, oh my gosh, but I feel terrible. I can't be happy with this guilt. So how do I get rid of the guilt? Then we feel we need to pay the same price that we killed God. Changing the will of God would be killing God. So then we said, okay, well, we have to die too. But they said, but if I die, how can we enjoy this experience? I can't. So we got to trick guilt somehow by making guilt think that we've died. And then guilt accepted our death. And then we say, ha-ha. You know, guilt has to vanish then. And then we say, okay, guilt's gone. And now we can enjoy the experience of being greater than God. That's where it came from. So we say, well, you know, we don't need it because there isn't any guilt. We didn't change the will of God. No guilt, no need for death. It's that simple. That's why we can set it down. In fact, there's never been a use for it, never been an application for death or sickness, you know, infirmity, vulnerability. There's never been any application for it. It's a scam in search of a mark, you know, that doesn't exist. The mark is guilt, but guilt doesn't exist. So we just, you know, we have this death universe, and we're looking for some application for it. There isn't any. No way to apply it. So we might as well see the pretense behind it all. It's all pretend. You know, spirit's just pretending. Spirit has never died. It's never been born, never died, never suffered, nothing. It's just a complete dream. It's just a dream. It's a dream. It's all it is a dream. Just like when we can go to bed and sleep, we can dream a dream of we're being tortured and everything, suffering. We wake up from the nightmare and realize, oh, it was all a dream. That's all it was. This whole situation of death, this dream of death is just a dream. That's all it is. And so we think it's happening to us. It's not. But we're trying to convince guilt that it is. So the dream is very creative and seemingly powerful and intense. And because we're really trying to convince guilt that it really is happening to spirit. So, you know, we're basically deceiving ourselves. Convincing ourselves it is happening to us so that guilt will believe it. And we keep thinking the reason why guilt doesn't believe it is because we haven't convinced ourselves, you know, not done a good enough job of deceiving ourselves. But the real reason is because there isn't any guilt. That's the real reason why it doesn't work. So it's trying to make it more intense is useless. It's stupid. It's useless. It's folly. And this is what the world is trying to do. Let's make it more intense. And that's just folly. Gets you nowhere. Except just terrible suffering. So, days are ticking away here. What is it today? 15th of July. The day of Jade Helmstars, which is a very bizarre situation, to say the least. There, you know, I mean, that's just another showing you, hey, turmoil is expected. Cyber warfare is expected. All sorts of stuff is being expected. Maybe even asteroid is being expected. There's a lot of pre-planning going on. You know, why is this happening on U.S. soil the way that it's happening? You know, that's not standard operating procedure at all. Military has vast, vast bases and land to carry out any war games they want to carry out. You know, why are, et cetera, you know, why? But then again, of course, well, the real story is Jesus, the King of the Jews, is back. That's the real story. And the fakers are trying desperately to, you know, convince us that they're the real messiahs, you know, real messiahs, and they're the ones that can lead us to salvation and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And just accept them and worship them and think that they got the answer. And so they're very desperate to try to look that way, you know, large and in charge, wearing the big pants, you know, like somehow that can fool us. No, not once have they ever talked in any way similar to Jesus. Not once have they really displayed true repentance at all, nor acknowledged Jesus really, truly at all. So, of course, they're trying to, you know, they're posers, false messiahs. Saying, yes, we can. Yes, we can fool guilt. You know, don't worry, I know the way. I know the way. I know how to fool guilt. That's not Jesus. Jesus will tell you there is no guilt. Okay? No guilt whatsoever. That's Jesus. Even though the world's frantically trying to make it appear as though there isn't any. Everything is a collaboration. Everything is in the nature of a dream. Here, no matter what it is, no matter how terrible it may seem, it's all a dream collaboration. There is actually no cause for guilt whatsoever. So I didn't fail to recognize, you know, my master's voice, the king of the Jews' voice. I heard it right away. I said, this is it. I can recognize that. I know who that is. I mean, I recognize this is truth speaking, you know. This is salvation speaking. That's great. And, you know, I listened to the POTUS for 10 minutes and listened to the mind, how it works. I said, oh, you know, this isn't Jesus. This is the ego. This is the ego talking. But again, the ego, what the ego tells everybody is, the ego says, hey, everybody, you know, I know the way. I know the way. I know how to fool guilt. We can do it. We can succeed. And the most people say, oh, wow, that's wonderful. Now, apropos of that, it's something pretty interesting and important here. This will be another wow statement. It's important to note that the 44th POTUS of the, you know, President of the United States is not the fault of Americans at all. It's the fault of the rest of the world, because it's the rest of the world that pressured America into going in that direction. And you see, what happened was the 43rd president was super unpopular around the world and actually made Americans very unpopular around the world. And Americans going around the world were under siege and people hated them. They were persona non grata. And the Americans thought, my God, this is horrible. You know, our image around the world is terrible. And what happened was the rest of the world said, hey, if you elect this guy, number 44, the way we want it, then we will give you, we'll say, hey, we like you again. We like you again. If you don't, we're going to keep hating you even worse and worse and worse. And so it's the rest of the world that said, hey, this guy's the answer. I mean, what was it, like 90, I think 98% of the world had a favorable opinion of POTUS number 44 around the rest of the world. In the United States, it's less than half, you know. I mean, we do not have a favorable opinion, but it's the rest of the world, 98%, 96 to 98% saying, this guy is the savior. You've got to elect him president or else we're going to reject you and isolate you. So I remember those days when 43 was in charge where I felt like the United States was going to be isolated, globally isolated, and we were hated. And people traveling abroad, they came back and said, what the heck, you know, we can't even travel. They despise us. And so the rest of the world really dictated to us, says, you got to elect this guy. And then they insisted we re-elect him too. They said, this is the guy that we want the United States to have. And the pressure was so intense on the United States that a lot of people caved into that. They caved in. They said, well, I don't want to be hated by the rest of the world. But there's sometimes, you know, you can't cave like that. You got to stand up. You got to stand up to the world and say, no. You're not going to tell us, you know, what our destiny is. And so it's really, you know, Americans have to stop blaming themselves and get over the guilt of this and say, you know, it's not our president, really. It's the rest of the world's president that they imposed upon us. That's really the fact. That's a fact. I mean, we're under this. This is like Pontius Pilate, you know, really. I mean, this is like a Roman proconsul, being put in charge, you know, by the rest of the world. It's like the Roman Empire. The rest of the world said, hey, America, we don't like what you're doing. We're going to put, you know, our proconsul, whatever the term is, we're going to put him in charge of this and govern this country so you can get in alignment with what we want you to do, getting back in alignment with Rome. That's what happened. That's what happened. I mean, the people of this world are like the people of Judea. And people of America are like people of Judea when they have Pontius Pilate governing them. Say, hey, you know, we don't like this. And there's a lot of zealots, a matter of fact, a lot of the, you know, Tea Party, Patriot movie, all these talk shows. These are zealots, and they hate it. It's the same thing with back then when Pontius Pilate was the governor general, say, governor general of Judea. Yeah, people hated it. It was imposed. A foreign empire had imposed this upon Judea. The fact is that the POTUS 44 is a foreign governor general that is being imposed upon the United States of America and by the rest of the world to get us in line, you know, with the 10 tribes agenda. The Lost Ten Tribes agenda, really. New World Order agenda. And America is the one holdout place where there's more true Jews in America than any place in the world, actually. Spiritual Jews. And so there's resistance. There's more Judeo-Christian resistance here than any place in the world. And then this zealot, you know, movement of the zealots has arisen, which is not what Jesus tells us. Jesus is a transcendentalist. He says, you know, give unto Rome the things that, you know, the Romans ask. But he's calling us to eternal life, which is freedom from this realm, this dark, you know, hellish dream of death realm. So, you know, there's a ton of zealots operating this way. And those are stirring up a great deal of anger from the Roman Empire, which is the New World Order, who has this, you know, what do you call it? Council General or something. Governor in Chief. Governor General. The Governor General. POTUS 44 is just an operative that actually answers to Rome. Which this number 44, POTUS, is really answering to the rest of the world. United Nations, the rest of the world. Not answering to us at all. He's imposing the will of the rest of the world upon America. And when our Constitution and our House, you know, the House, Senate, House of Representatives, Congress, when Congress says, hey, no, that's against our rules. He says, so what? This is the way the world wants it. This is the way it shall be. I'll just tell you, it's an executive decision, executive order. I don't have to go through you at all. And the people are just like in shock. What are you doing? Well, that's just like Governor General Pontius Pilate said, hey, you know, you're going to do things the way Rome tells you to do. I'll give you a little slack here and there, but, you know, this is the way it is. This is the way it is. And that's exactly what's happening in this world, isn't it? That's exactly what's happening. When people question, you know, birthers questioning, what they're saying is, hey, I don't think this guy really, you know, I think he's being imposed upon America by foreign powers. Absolutely. And this is their feeling, and it's very true, very true. The various deals and treaties I made are not in the best interest of America at all. They're in the best interest of the New World Order. There's no question about it. yeah, this is not a real president at all. It's a governor generalship being imposed by the rest of the world upon the United States. You know, and now we know. Now we know the cat's out of the bag. Cat's out of the bag. And this Jade Helm thing has something to do with that. Something of the New World Order preparing, you know, to deal with dissidents here. Or, you know, dissidents and whatever. You know, it's something that's very suspect for sure. Zealots are very aware of that. And the zealots are not stupid, let's be clear about that. They have a pretty good idea what's going on. They're a little, you know, some of them can be a bit loopy, but they're throwing ideas, they're brainstorming, they're trying to figure out, you know. So you realize when they say stuff, they're trying to throw as much, they're brainstorming, thinking, oh, okay, let me see this, and then gradually they get a clear picture of it. Like that, so you understand what they're doing, you know. Just because it doesn't make them crazy, just because they're brainstorming, you know, and not everything they say turns out to be accurate. They're just trying to get a handle on what's very tricky, very, very tricky indeed. But I'm not a zealot. I'm a true Jew, tribe of Judah, spiritual tribe. So I'm not a zealot at all. Jesus rejected zealotry, rejected Barabbas, absolutely rejected Barabbas, who was leader of the zealots, and the revolt that eventually came, which was disastrous, of course. History repeating itself here, for sure. So, of course, the Antichrist will come, the false Messiah will come as a man of peace, great peace, peace, peace. I'm bringing peace everywhere. I'm negotiating great peace treaties. I'm bringing peace to the world. The only peace he's not bringing is peace to the country that he's governing over, you know, as governor general. He's bringing absolute chaos there. I mean, Pilate did not, you know, succeed in very well, right? I mean, the zealots did have a rebellion. They were a thorn in the side of the Romans, for sure. Very nasty thorn in the side. Romans lost a tremendous amount of power and suffered great casualties from the zealots and the rebellions. But, of course, the zealots suffered even worse, say the least. So, I've always said to everybody involved, all parties, turn to Jesus, turn to the King of the Jews, turn to the one who's recognized the falsity of death. That's your real salvation, only that. Don't make illusions true and try to escape from them. Don't make guilt true and then try to escape from it. That's the false path of arrogance, the ego. So, you know, we have to get this video out. We're flying high here. I mean, the times are, it's popping. I mean, the popcorn is popping right now. And you know what happens once a certain temperature, you know, in the microwave, the popcorn just, it all goes at once almost. And it's fast and furious, to say the least. So, you know, we have to go big here, which we are doing. And we'll go bigger and bigger. Again, we're not zealots. We don't threaten anyone. We're transcendentalists. We're preparing to listen to what Jesus has to say in terms of, you know, how do you set death down? We're not a threat to the world or any institutions or anything like that. We're trying to bring people everyone back to sanity, that this is all a dream. It's a completely unnecessary dream. That's all it is. And then the right spiritual practice to handle the intensity of this recognition, which produces a backlash of continuity fear. You know, so you have to go bit by bit by bit and gradually wear away that backlash. This is the discipline that's needed. all this manipulation of our psychology just to believe that we can figure out a way to keep being happy with this scam of death. You know, we stay happy with death. Let's keep it going until we finally succeed. That's all that they're really doing. You know, profiling you to say, hey, don't worry, we've got your profile. We know what you're really like. So there's no reason to think about it, worry about it. We'll make sure that you know, get the right color smartphone. We've profiled you. We know all your preferences. We know exactly how you like to live. And we'll make sure that you get to live that way and you can be happy with death. And we'll keep it going. And eventually, you know, we'll finally succeed in fooling guilt that doesn't exist and has never existed and never will. So again, it's completely absurd. This dream of death is at zero relevance. Absurd, 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 absurd. Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the absurdity here. Fear is the absurdity here, okay? Death is the absurdity here. I'm home. This is where I am now. Death is the absurdity here. Could say that death is the absurdity here. Fear is the absurdity here. Guilt is the absurdity here. I'm home. This is where I am now. Death is the absurdity here. Dreaming is the absurdity here. Fear is the absurdity. Dreaming is the absurdity. Death is the absurdity. The dream of death is the absurdity here. I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. You can say that. I am home. This is where I am now. Death, the dream of death is the absurdity here. See, there's an absurdity somewhere. We have to identify where it is. Otherwise, we think we're the absurdity. That we're absurdity unto ourselves. And then, you know, then we'll continue on with this nonsense. So we have to say, hey, I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. So, yeah, I am home. This is where I am now. I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. Just say that. Say it. Very powerful. Don't worry about results. Results will rise spontaneously when you've removed the blocks to their presence. So, the presence is already within us. We just have to remove the blocks to, the full awareness of it. So, this is why we just practice. We don't worry about results. They'll arrive on their own once we've removed the blocks. Of course they will. So, I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. I am home. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity here. This is home. I am 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 home. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. It is fear. The dream of, it is fear that has the absurdity here. It is a dream of death that has the absurdity here. I'm home. This is my home. It's the dream of death that's the absurdity here. Not me. I'm sanity. I'm the same. I'm dwelling in the home of sanity, which is my home. I am home. I am dwelling in the home of sanity. This is where I am now. It's the absurd dream of death that's the stranger here. It's the absurd dream of death that's the stranger here. That's the odd person. That's the odd one out here. It's the dream of death. That is the absurdity here. Okay? Keep flipping the script. See, we're flipping the script, getting used to flipping the script. So it's, you know, comes easy to us. So we say, oh yeah, I can do this. It's easy. Because the backlash will come. I mean, it does. It tries to reform itself and come after you again. So I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's a dream of death. That's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's a dream of death. That's the absurdity. It's similar to, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am home now. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death that's the absurdity. I am home, I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death that's the absurdity. So you keep asserting this, keep asserting this. I am home, I am free. This is where I am now. It's a dream of death, that's the absurdity. I am home now, I am free. This is where I am now. It's fear that is the absurdity. I am home, I am free. This is where I am now. It's fear that's the absurdity. Fear is the absurdity. Can't full stop in the wow when you practice. Don't look for results. Don't anticipate. Don't try to think what they could be. It must be this, must be that. You know, you just keep practicing. Keep your will, keep asserting it. Keep asserting it. In the face of resistance, keep asserting it. The whole world's screaming at you to shut up. You don't shut up. You say, hey, I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death. That's the absurdity. I am home now, I am free. This is where I am now. It's the world, that's the absurdity. I am home now, I am free. This is where I am now. It's the universe, that's the absurdity. I am home now, I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of the universal dream of death. That's the absurdity. So this video is letting us go. I set the length of it properly. It's a good sign. It's very weird here. The temperature like gets up high to like 91, but it's a cool 91. I can't explain it. Nobody seems to be complaining. It's like there's like a breeze or there's something. It's just like 90, 91. Oh, I mean, it's nothing. Doesn't even feel very hot. Strange. Maybe just getting used to it. Same way we can get used to these assertions. I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am home, I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death that's the absurdity. That's the strange absurdity. It's the absurd dream of death that's the stranger here, but that doesn't rhyme. It's, I am home, I am free, I am... This is where I am now. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death, that's the absurdity. See, saying that I'm home, that I'm free, this is where I am now. That's not an absurdity. It's the dream of death, that's the absurdity, that claims I'm not home. That claims I'm a body. That claims I'm in a world. That claims I'm subject to death. That's the absurdity. That's complete absurdity. To say that of spirit is an absolute bizarre, whimsical, capricious absurdity. Arrogant absurdity, totally arrogant absurdity, completely ridiculous. So that's the absurdity. No, I am home, I am spirit, I am free. This is where I am now, is the dream of death, that's the absurdity. I am home, I am free. This is where I am now, is the dream of death, that's the absurdity. I am home now, I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity. Now this is shaking up the psyche here. Finally I'm feeling the wow of this. You have to be very emphatic about your practicing. Try to keep practicing. Keep working. You'll get second wind, third wind, until you can become very emphatic about it. With great emphasis and insist upon it. And this is where you will feel then the wow. Suddenly you feel the whole, your whole psyche is sort of melting and changing and being tinted into a different look. I remember we were watching a final game of the basketball season when the Warriors won the championship, and there's we were in a sports bar, and everybody was cheering, having a great time, but it was missing something. It was missing something. Nobody was quite willing to be a cheerleader, and then finally one guy had the guts to do it, and he said, "Let's go, Warriors! Clap, 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 clap." And after a while, the whole place was just, you know, going along with it, and it was just, the place was just rocking. I mean, it just became very intense and tremendous. It was really quite an experience. It was really, and so, and yet, you know, it was only this guy that had the guts to do it. And I appreciated it, you know. I didn't have the guts to do it. I'm not that guy. I'm not quite able to bellow out in a crowd like that. But he was able to. Same thing with the Giants when they won the World Series in 2014. There was a guy who was also able to do this and got everybody else going. So, you know, you need these people. You know, we need these people who are able to bellow out, you know, and say, hey. Bellow out in a crowd, and then the rest will say, "Hey, yeah, I want to do this. I just need somebody to get me going, and I'll go along with this." And so we just say, "Hey, I am home. I'm home. I'm free. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death. That's the absurdity, you know. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Like that, you know? That's it. I mean, why not? Let's go, Jesus. Yeah. Because this is what he's saying. Hey, I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death. That's the absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. I need to get a Jesus jersey or a Jesus hat. I don't have a Jesus hat. I need to get one. Yeah, let's go, Jesus. Coming from a true Jew, you know, recognizing the King of the Jews. This is apostolic. This is different than trying to call down a warrior king. You know, we're not doing that. We're celebrating liberation. Hey, I am home. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death. That's the absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. You know, yes, 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 yes. Let's win the championship. Let's win the championship. You know, it's game seven. Time to win the championship here. Yeah, absolutely. We're in a tight contest here, so to speak. So we got to get into this. I think Jesus needs his cheerleaders to start showing up here. You know, start rocking the place. We don't really want to go along with what's happening in the world. No, New World Agenda and all this nonsense. Yeah, we can find a way to trick guilt. No, we can't. We don't want to go along with that. That's an absurdity. Absurd, he's a stranger here. I am home, I am free. This is where I am now. Absurdity's the stranger here now for me. Yeah, the dream of death is the absurdity. Fear is the absurdity. This is, I'm home, I'm free, this is where I am now. It's fear, that's the absurdity. It's a dream of death, that's the absurdity. Keep pushing that, keep pushing that, keep pushing that. Let's go, Jesus. Time to win the championship now, that is for sure. We'll see what happens. So maybe if you get this chant, let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. And just keep this chant going in your mind. It's like, just imagine there's a whole huge crowd of people, 100,000 stadium full. And they're all saying it, chanting, let's go, Jesus. You know, just imagine that, how powerful that is. Just assert, 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 assert. Let's go, Jesus. We're done with this absurdity. Absurdity is the stranger here. Yeah, absurdity is the stranger. That's the one that's got to leave. I'm at home here. I'm at home. This is where I am now. I'm home. I'm free. It's freedom. That's my home. It's dream of death. That's the absurdity. It's a dream of bodies, that's the absurdity. Dream of nature, that's the absurdity. Dream of time, space, process, and form, that's the absurdity. Okay. And this is what Jesus is here to liberate us from. So let's go, Jesus. Like that. 100,000 people. Massive rally. Let's go, Jesus. Like that. Got to do it fast. It's got to happen fast here. The world is collapsing. It really is. Collapsing into idolatry. False messianic idolatry. False hope. Severe, you know, antichrist delusion. Egoic delusion. Arrogant delusion. So, you know, we got to get our momentum going here. That's not for us. It's an absurdity. That's an absurdity. Absurdity is a stranger here. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Dream of death is the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity. The dream of the flesh is the absurdity. Okay, I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death, the dream of flesh is the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of flesh is the absurdity. The crazy lunatic stranger, the alien stranger, totally alien stranger, lunatic alien stranger. Okay, I am home, I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of the flesh is the lunatic alien absurdity. Dream of death is a lunatic alien absurdity. I am home, I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death is a lunatic alien absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Right? Because we're hearing the gospel now. We're hearing the gospel. The gospel is being proclaimed. When this practice, this is the proclamation of the gospel here and in this world. By doing this practice, you are absolutely proclaiming the gospel, which is, of course, the good news that Jesus, the King of the Jews, came to bring us. Those who are Jews in spirit, following the turning around of Judas, saying, "Hey, no, we're not going to use death. We're not going to use it. It's out. It's off. It's not on the menu anymore. Forget it." Say no to death. Say no to death. Say no to death. Absolutely. It's an absurdity. The dream of the flesh is the alien, lunatic alien absurdity. So let's go, Jesus. Let him hear it. He's here. He's back. Let him hear it. Let him hear it. Yeah. I mean, what do you want? What do we want? Like to argue about stuff and debate stuff? And no, let him hear it. Say, hey, let's go, Jesus. Let's bring it on. I mean, yes, 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 yes. We're totally into that you're here, and totally into the message. This is it. Let's go. You know. You go. I mean, let's. We're supporting you 100%. 100%. We're behind you. You're the leader of the team, so to speak. We're the ultimate fans here. You know. Let's go, Jesus. Yes. 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 Let's go, Jesus. Yes. 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 Let's go, Jesus. Yes. 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 Let's go, Jesus. Yes. 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 I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of the flesh that is a lunatic alien absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death that's the lunatic alien absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. 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 That, something like that. You know, like a band, real popular headliner band, they're ready to appear, and they, you know, the stage is lit and everything's ready, and you're like, and they don't come on stage, right? And people are kind of starting, you know, murmuring a little bit, and where are they? Hey, you know, let's go, you know, yeah. People are shouting out, and then finally someone starts to chant. You know, people start clap, 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 clap. Yeah, yeah. And the crowd finally is just like, you know, tremendous applause. And then once the act hears that, boom, then they come out on stage and said, you're ready for us, you know. You're ready for us. You weren't ready for us before. You got to be fired up to be ready for this. Because you gotta bring the intensity up to be ready to match the intensity that we're going to bring here. Crowd's got to get ready, and this is part of the whole thing. I mean, the crowd can't just be kind of waiting and say, well, I don't know. Well, I'm not sure how it's going to be. I hope it's going to be okay. Say, no, you got to say, hey, I know it's going to be fabulous. I know this is going to be the best thing I've ever heard. And so I am absolutely fired up. You know, bring it on. I am ready. Bring it on. I am ready. So let's go, Jesus. Bring it on. We're ready. Bring it on. Bring the gospel. You know, bring the full gospel, the full grace of the gospel right now. We are ready to hear it. We're ready to receive it. And we have to say, let's go, Jesus. You know, we're ready to receive it. You know, I am home. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Okay? In home. I'm my home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death that is the absolute lunatic alien absurdity. It's completely alien to me. It's a complete stranger to me. So let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Yeah. You know, you're just saying, yep, I'm with the gospel here. I'm celebrating the gospel. Let's celebrate the gospel together, Jesus. This is where we're saying, let's celebrate the gospel together here. You know? You know, let's bring on the one that the head cheerleader, which is Jesus. I mean, you know, you never seen a cheerleader till you've seen Jesus. It'll really get us going. And so we got to let them know that we're ready to get going here. Let's go, Jesus, meaning let's get us going. Come on, get us going. We want that cheerleader here, you know. So let's get going. Let's warm up. Let's get it warmed up here. So this is a vastly incomparably better video than the one I didn't post. The one that derailed people a little bit. This is, you know, where we need to get to. This is where we needed to get to tonight. And so we are now firing on all cylinders here. We're calling for the head cheerleader to start doing the cheers. Yes, we can. Yes, I am home. I am free. I am. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death. That's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream is the dream of death. That's the lunatic alien absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death. That's the absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. So you're hearing it here first, ground zero. This is where the grassroots groundswell. This is where the cheerleading starts, you know. This is where we start it up. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Little golf clap. Let's go, Jesus. Like that. You know, just do a little golf clap. Let's go, Jesus. Yes, we can do that. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the bizarre alien absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of flesh is the bizarre alien absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the lunatic, bizarre, alien absurdity. I am home. I am free. I am home. I am free. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. 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 I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. This is where I am now. It's the dream of the flesh, which is the bizarre, insane, lunatic, alien absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. 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 Now, using the term Jesus, it fits well in this chat. Is if you say, let's go, Yeshua. Let's go, Yeshua. I guess you could do that too. Let's go, Jesus. Boom, 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 boom. It's all good. A rose is a rose. Why any other name is still a rose, right? Let's go, freedom. Let's go, freedom. Let's go home. Let's go home. Let's go, freedom. Let's go 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 Jesus. Let's go Yeshua. I think Yeshua means something like Joseph or something. I don't know. I think it's something like that. Was his father? Wasn't his father Joseph? Yeah. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Bum, 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 bum. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's the dream of death is the absurdity. I am home now. I am free. This is where I am now. The dream of death is the absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's a dream of death. That's the absurdity. This is where I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. It's a dream of death. That's the crazy, lunatic, insane, bizarre, whimsical, capricious, arrogant absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Yes, indeed. Who wants to stop? Gotta keep the popcorn popping here. Like I said, Jesus is back. He's backstage. Let's bring him out. He's just waiting. He says, anybody out there want to hear? You know, going to follow the cheers? Anybody out there want to, you know, follow the cheers? And he's waiting. Backstage just waiting. Guarantee he's there. Maybe that's my role. Just, you know, sometimes in a musical act, you know, the stage is empty. They're not showing up. Oh, my God, maybe they didn't make it here. You know, maybe something happened. You worry about it, but someone comes down and says, "Hey, they're here. They're backstage. They just want to hear. You know, they want to hear if you're ready for them. Come on, let them hear it. Let them hear it." And the crowd starts saying, "Hey, come on, yeah." So I'm telling you, Jesus is backstage. He is here. He is back. Let him hear it. Let him hear it from your heart, from your spirit. Say, "Hey, I want the gospel, Jesus. Proclaim the gospel to me. Be the cheerleader. Come on." Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go home. I'd be like Bobby Darin, Beyond the Sea. You know what? This song doesn't really end, you know? It doesn't end. There's no ending to this song. You know? No more sailing. Ain't gonna be bailing. Ain't no ending. I'm just pretending, somewhere beyond the sea. So when you say let's go Jesus, let's go freedom, let's go home, no more Roman, no more Rome, no more Rome, no more Rome, let's go Jesus, let's go freedom, let's go home, no more Rome, like that. Yeah, there you go. Rome can have a double meaning there, right? Roaming, I don't need to roam anymore in the dream of death. And also, you know, we've graduated from Rome. The New World Order, Rome, Roman Catholic Church, you know, it's got a lot of meanings to it. No more Rome, no more Rome. Let's go Jesus. Let's go freedom. Let's go home. No more Rome. Yeah, that's nice. That's a great one right there. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Here we go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. So I got, let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Here we go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Yeah, let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Here we go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Go, 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 Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. That's actually a chant that was used in the 2010 Giants World Series. Let's get fired up. 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 Here we go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Yeah, let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Here we go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Yeah. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go. Let's go home. No more Rome. Yeah, let's get fired up. 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 Here we go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Yeah, let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go home. No more Rome. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Here we go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Yeah, let's go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Let's go, Jesus. Here we go, Jesus. Yeah, let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's go, Jesus. Let's go, freedom. Let's go home. No more roam. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death is the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home and I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. Let's go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. 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 This is where I am now. This is home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. This is home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. I am home. I am free. This is where I am now. Death's the absurdity. See, let's go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. Let's go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. Let's go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. There we go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. Here we go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's get fired up. Let's go, Jesus. Let's get fired up. Yeah, so doing the cheerleading, initial cheerleading session here, a little pep rally for Jesus. Why not a pep rally for Jesus?